Thank you. Thank you. Good morning, everybody, and a very, very warm welcome to worship, wherever you happen to be today and you're joining with us, whether online or in one of our congregations. Please know that you're very, very welcome. We're going to have a word now with all of our neighbouring congregations just to get a sense of what's been going on this week and also to find what's coming up in the week to come. So, Neil, Kintore, how are things over with you?
All going well in Kintore, thank you. Lovely to see you all. I guess the only thing I want to mention today is to point your attention to a group that we have in Kintore. I think I've mentioned them before, Sustainable Kintore. This is a group who are very interested in the climate change and climate justice issues. And with COP26 coming up very shortly, they're starting to move. They've been meeting with MPs and MSPs to talk about climate justice issues. And if you'd like to know more about what Sustainable Kintore are doing, please take a look at our websites, kintorekirk.org.uk, and there is a Sustainable Kintore tab for you to look at.
Great, thanks. Thank you, Neil, for that. Stella, news from Blairdaff and Chapel of Ely.
Hello, good morning. It's lovely to think that we've got some planning in the future, and we've put a date in for some coffee mornings and Christmas activities on the 27th of November. So that's the last Saturday of November from 10 to 2. So pop that in your diary because it's really nice to have something coming along. Tozy will be with us in Chapel of Yeary this morning, so we look forward to trying and helping him explore the Doric dialect a little bit more. And just a word, I think that's the last of the swallows. I haven't seen any for a few days and the weather's definitely turned chiller, so I'm sure Godspeed to them as they go on their way to South Africa and beyond. Okay, that's us from the north.
Well, those are going and the geese are coming back, Stella. They're passing the manse here in Echt. So, Ewan, over to you for news from Cluny and Monymusk.
Well, hello. It's nice to be able to speak to you. I had our first baptism last weekend, and for the first time, and I'm not going to say the name of the family, but for the first time in 30 years, a baby cried during the baptism, and that broke my heart, that broke my record, but it was lovely seeing folk. And I have to say, a number of visitors in the church actually enjoyed the blether, and that's, they made a point of saying how much they enjoyed listening to the blether of what was going on, so that was good. There's not much going on. We have our Harvest Thanksgiving today, and it's at Cluny, and there's Sunday school, and tea's after the service, and a collection of foodstuffs for the local food bank. And so that's what's happening. And next week we'll be just back to normal worshipping at Cluny at 10 o'clock.
Thanks, Ewan. Joshua, you're over in Kemnay. How's life over with you?
Hi, everybody. Nice to see everyone. Things are going fine, I think. Just a couple things to share from the Kemnay side of things. Going forward into this week, we'll continue to have our lunch club on Tuesdays and Thursdays from 12 until 2 at the church center. And this is aimed primarily at vulnerable folk in our communities who might need some extra support as we continue to find our way through this pandemic. And also on another note, I'm taking leave for the month of October. So I won't be present in Kemnay for any of the October worship services or for, besides this blether, the joint services as well. But in terms of worshiping Kemnay, we'll have a variety of different opportunities for worship, different styles of worship on Sunday mornings, including some praise services and some guest preachers, including Reverend Toze, who's graciously joining us for worship on the 24th of October. And we're very much looking forward to that, Tozzi. So that's all from Kemnay.
Thanks, Joshua. And we wish you a great month off and look forward to seeing you when you're back.
Thank you.
Tozzi, good morning to you. How's your week been and what's your news?
Yeah, morning to you. My week was a little bit good though. I experienced in two funerals and Holy Communion for the first time according to the culture of the Scottish people. As a man who is on a learning curve, I learned a lot as far as how you do your things here, how the Holy Communion is being partaken here, but I was very happy that the liturgy on both sides, on the funerals, and at the same time on the Holy Communion is one and the same, and sometimes word to word. So I was very happy to experience those two activities during the week. However, as a man who is on a learning curve, you'll be with your book every day, writing down some questions to ask soon after the service to understand what actually was happening. I think on my side, that was how my week was all about.
Well, if it's any consolation, Cody, it's still all a learning curve for us as well, I think. and it should be, I guess, but it's great to hear that you're finding your feet, and I know people are really appreciating your worship.
Okay, thank you.
Things at Echt and Midmar are well. We're celebrating another baptism this week, which is lovely, and of course we're looking forward as a grouping to next steering group meeting, which comes up this coming week. We'll continue the discussions that we're having about the future of the relationship that we're in between our congregations. So we're looking forward to taking those talks further as well. And of course, our collection for Blythswood, the charity Blythswood Care, is now underway, and we welcome donations from all of our sister churches as well, if anybody's interested. So we go now to worship. We worship together and we worship in our sister churches. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it.
Jesus calls us to follow. Then he goes to the poor and the weak. Jesus says, "Follow me." And then he travels to where he can heal the sick and forgive the sinners. Jesus says, "Come," and then he leads us to the cross. Hear the call, and let us live lives worthy of that call. Let us worship God together.
Thank you.
Our reading today comes from Psalm 8, reading from the Good News Bible. Listen for the word of God. O Lord, our Lord, your greatness is seen in all the world. Your praise reaches up to the heavens. It is sung by children and babies. You are safe and secure from all your enemies. You stop anyone who opposes you. When I look at the sky, which you have made, at the moon and the stars, which you set in their places, what are human beings that you think of them? Mere mortals that you care for them. Yet you made them inferior only to yourself. You crowned them with glory and honor. You appointed them rulers over everything you made. You placed them over all creation, sheep and cattle, and the wild animals too, the birds and the fish, and the creatures in the seas. O Lord, our God, Lord, your greatness is seen in all the world. May God bless to us the reading of his holy word. Amen.
Let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the thoughts of our hearts be acceptable to you, our Lord and our Redeemer. Amen. It was a cold, frosty morning. I had been at a 21st birthday party, and I was driving some folk back to their homes after the party. After dropping the folk off, I was returning to a rural location where the party was held, and I had to stop my car in the middle of nowhere. It was dark. It was between 2 and 3 o'clock in the morning, if I recall. And I just had to get out of the car. It was frosty, it was freezing, but I had to look at the night sky. There wasn't a cloud in the sky. There was no street lamps, there was nothing to interfere with the beauty that I could see looking at the sky. I looked up at the sky and saw these stars. And if I could have counted them, there must have been millions of them, all shining from so far away or so long ago. And I suddenly felt in the presence of God. When I look at the sky which you have made, at the moon and stars which you set in their places, what are human beings that you think of them? Mere mortals that you care for them. Like the psalmist of long ago, I was overwhelmed by the wonder of nature, the night sky, and the God who created them. And it struck me that that God was with me at that moment. And I know that because he loves me. And in that brief feeling of the presence of God, I just knew that I was surrounded by his love. Now, I can't prove it to you. I have no clever argument that makes that so. I simply in that night sky could see. When I look at the sky which you have made, at the moon and stars which you set in their places, what are human beings that you think of them? Mere mortals that you care for them. And I would suspect anyone that night who stopped and looked at the sky would have felt moved by the beauty of nature. And it wasn't twinkle, twinkle, little star. It was a myriad of stars lightening the cold night air. And I can understand why in the history of religion, how such scenes make people think beyond themselves and point to a deity, sometimes in the sun or the moon or the stars. But that night, I wasn't thinking in the abstract, but in the person of God in Jesus Christ, looking at these same stars when he made his earthly journey, when he stopped by the fireside at night, looking up into the sky over Israel. Some of these stars he looked at were the same stars that I was looking at. And I felt God near and Jesus felt his love surround me. And more than 30 years later, though I did not have a picture of that event, it is as clear in my mind's eye as it was through my own eyes. And that feeling of God is with me. A number of years ago, when I was my first year at university, Christ College had closed down and they were clearing out the building in preparation for it to be sold. They had a clear out of their old books. And I went to purchase some books simply to support Christ College, of which I'm wearing their tie today. And I bought an old book. It's an old book, it's even older than I am. It's a book by J.B. Phillips, A New Testament Christology. Now, J.B. Phillips is famous for having a translation of the scriptures. That was what he did. He translated scripture, but he also wrote some lovely little books. And this book contains a story, and I'm not going to preach to you on that, Sam. I'm going to read you a wee story that he wrote as part of this book. And it's complete fantasy. There's no basis of reality to it, perhaps, but it just tells me a story. So if you're sitting comfortably, please listen and hear him speak this story to you. Once upon a time, that's a great way to start a story, a young angel was being shown round the splendours and glories of the universes by a senior and experienced angel. To tell the truth, the young angel was getting a bit tired and bored. He'd been shown whirling galaxies and blazing suns, infinite distances and deadly cold of the interstellar space. And to his mind, there seemed like an awful lot to take in. Finally, he was shown a galaxy of which our planetary system is but a small part. And as the two of them draw near to a star which we call the Sun and its circling planets, the senior angel pointed out to small and rather insignificant sphere turning very slowly on its axis. It looked as dull as a dirty tennis ball to the little angel, whose mind was filled with the size and glory of all that he had seen. "I want you to watch that one particularly," said the senior angel, pointing with his finger. "Well, it looks very small and rather dirty to me," said the little angel. "What's special about that one?" "That," replied the senior solemnly, "is the visited planet."
"Visited?" the little one said. "You don't mean visited by..."
"Indeed I do. That ball, which I have no doubt looks to you small and insignificant and not perhaps over clean, has been visited by our Prince of Glory." And at these words, he bowed his head reverently.
"But how," queried the younger one, "do you mean that the great and glorious Prince, with all these wonders and splendours of creation and millions more that I'm sure I've yet to see, went down in person to this fifth late little ball? Why should he do such a thing like that?"
"It isn't for us," said the senior a little stiffly, "to question his whys, except that I must point out to you that he is not impressed by size and numbers, as you seem to be. But he really went, I know, and all of us in heaven who know anything know that. As to why he became one of them, how else do you suppose he could have visited them?" The little angel's face wrinkled in disgust.
"Do you mean to tell me," he said, "that he stooped so low as to become one of those creeping, crawling creatures of that floating ball?"
"I do. And I don't think he would like you to call them creeping, crawling creatures in that tone of voice. For strange as it may seem to us, he loves them. He went down to visit them, to lift them up, to become like him." The little angel looked blank. Such a thought was almost beyond his comprehension. "Close your eyes for a moment," said the senior angel, "and we will go back in what they call time." while the little angel's eyes were closed and the two of them moved nearer to the spinning ball, it stopped its spinning and spun backwards quite fast for a while and then slowly resumed its normal rotation. Now look. And the little angel did as he was told. There appeared here and there at the dull surface of the globe little flashes of light, some merely momentarily and some persisting for a while. Well, what am I seeing now? Queried the little angel. You're watching this little world as it is some thousands of years ago, returned his companion. Every flash and glow of light that you see is something of the Father's knowledge and wisdom breaking into the minds and hearts of the people who live upon the earth. Not many people, you see, can hear his voice or understand what he says, even though he is speaking gently and quietly to them all the time. Why are they so blind and deaf and stupid? Asked the junior angel rather crossly. It's not for us to judge them. We who live in the splendour have no idea what it's like to live in the dark. We hear the music and the voice like the sound of many waters every day of our lives, but to them, well, there is much darkness, much noise, and much distraction upon the earth. Only a few of them are quiet and humble and wise, hear his voice. But watch for a moment and you will see something truly wonderful. The earth went on turning and circling round, and then quite suddenly in the upper half of the globe there appeared a light, tiny but so bright in its intensity that both the angels hid their eyes. I think I can guess, said the little angel in a low voice. That was the visit, wasn't it? Yes, that was the visit. The light himself went down there and lived among them. But in a moment, and you will be able to tell that even with your eyes closed, the light will go out. But why? Could he not bear their darkness and stupidity? Did he have to return home? No, it wasn't that, returned the senior angel. His voice became stern and sad. They failed to recognize him for who he was, or at least only a handful knew him. For the most part, they preferred their darkness to his light, and in the end, they killed him. The fools, the crazy fools, they don't deserve. Neither you nor I, any other angel, knows why they were so foolish and so wicked. Nor can we say what they deserve or don't deserve, but the fact remains, they killed our Prince of Glory while he was man among them. And I suppose that's the end. I see the whole earth has gone black and dark. All right, I won't judge them, but surely that's all they could expect. Wait, we are still far from the end of the story of the visited planet. Watch now. But be ready to cover your eyes again. In utter blackness, the earth turned round three times, and then there blazed with unbearable radiance a bright of light. What now? Asked the little angel, shielding his eyes. They killed him, all right, but he conquered death, the thing most of them dread and fear all their lives. He broke and conquered. He rose again. And a few of them saw him, and from then on became his utterly devoted servants. Thank God for that, said the little angel. Amen. Open your eyes now. The dazzling light has gone. The prince has returned to his home of light. But watch the earth now. As they looked in place of the dazzling light, there was a bright glow which throbbed and pulsated, and then as the earth turned many times, little points of light spread out. A few flickered and died, but for the most part the lights burned steadily, and they continued to watch in many parts of the globe. There was a glow over many areas. You see what's happening? Asked the senior angel. The bright glow is the company of loyal men and women he left behind. And with his help, they spread the glow, and now lights begin to shine all over the earth. Yes, yes, said the little angel impatiently. But how does it end? Will the lights join up with each other? Will all be light as it is in heaven? We simply do not know, replied the senior. It's in the Father's hands. Sometimes it's agony to watch, and sometimes it's joy unspeakable, but the end is not yet. But now I'm sure you can see why this little ball is so important. He visited it. He is working out his plan upon it. Yes, I see. Though I don't understand, I shall never forget that this is the visited planet. It's just a story. But it says something that the psalmist said. When I look at the sky which you have made, at the moon and stars which you set in their places, what are human beings that you think of them? Mere mortals that you care for them. The visited planet is not just a planet. It's you and me who have been visited, who have been touched, and who are called to be lights in a dark world. It's a challenge.
Shine on the white shine.
We are here at this table because Jesus himself invites us. When Jesus was on earth, he often enjoyed meals with his friends. On the night before he died, when darkness was beginning to fall, he sat at table with his disciples in an upper room in Jerusalem. At this Last Supper, he broke bread and took wine and told his disciples to remember him by following his example. Today, we are his disciples, and we are glad to do what he told us. And so, as the Lord Jesus took bread, we take these elements of bread and wine to be set apart from all common use to this holy use and mystery. And as Jesus gave thanks to his heavenly Father, let us also draw near with our prayers of thanksgiving. Let us pray. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Loving God, you made this world marvelous for us to enjoy. You gave Jesus to be our friend and to bring us to you. You send your Holy Spirit to make us one family in Christ. For these gifts of your love, we thank you. And we join with the angels and the saints in this joyful hymn of praise, saying, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. For your kindness to us and your goodness to all, we give you thanks. We thank you that you showed your love by sending your Son, who gave his life for us and rose again from death and lives to pray for us forever. We thank you that he has taken away all that separates us from you and has made us friends with you and with one another. We thank you that he has brought us together at this table to strengthen us by his love. And so we pray that you would send your Holy Spirit upon us and these your gifts of bread and wine, that we may know Christ's presence, real and true, and be his faithful followers, showing your love for the world. Through Christ, with Christ, in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, Almighty Father, forever. And so, as Jesus taught his disciples, let us pray together, saying, Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. And so, according to our Lord's command and his institution, and in remembrance of him, we do this, who on the night of his arrest took bread, and after he had given thanks, he broke it and said, Take, eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant sealed in my blood. Drink of it, all of you, in remembrance of me." And so taste and see that the Lord is good. We do this in remembrance of him. So wherever you are now, I invite you to join us in this meal as we eat and drink in remembrance of Jesus. When Jesus rose from the dead, he came and stood amongst his friends and showed them his hands and his side. And he said to them, "Peace be with you. In his name and in his risen presence, I say, the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you." Let us pray. Gracious God, we thank you for your goodness to us at the table of our Lord, where we have remembered him and offered ourselves to his service till he comes again in glory. In the name of our Lord, we pray for all the children of your love. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. So bring nearer the day when all people will live in peace and praise of your name forever. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
There are things in all of our lives and in our world for which we would want to give thanks today, for knowing peace more than we know insecurity, for knowing friendship more than we know isolation, for the privilege of being part of a community of faith which gives our lives direction and meaning and purpose. We give thanks too for those things that are important to us, whether great or small, and which we name before God in a moment's silence. And as we think of those things in our lives for which we're grateful, we're prompted to offer our prayers of concern and compassion for the people in situations near or far that require our prayer at this time. We think of people caught up in terrorism in all sorts of different places in the world, places where war has the upper hand, or where people are caught in a seemingly relentless cycle of violence. We pray for peacemakers, the people who can see hope in the most hopeless of situations, people whose insistence or determination sow even the smallest seeds of change and transformation. And we pray for the people who are, in some way or another, examples to others, perhaps because of their knowledge, their faith, their compassion, their humour, their ability to love, or their resilience. We pray for people who are facing uncertainty of health, home life, or work. People who are putting a brave face on each new day and are concealing how hard each new week can really be. Loving God, you offer healing and wholeness in ways that we can't always understand. But we pray nevertheless for your healing and wholeness,
for all those different people who've crossed our minds and our paths during the last week. Guide, strengthen, and support us and those whom we love and care for, now and always.
Now, go in peace. And may the blessing of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and those you love, today and always. Amen.